Shake the walls, won't stop until I see them fall. Gonna stand up, step out when you call. Jesus, Jesus. And I'll sing and shout and shake the walls, won't stop until I see them fall. Gonna stand up, step out when you call. Jesus, give me faith like Daniel.
Thanks, Praise Team, for leading us in that first song. We thank you for the time to come up here and record it. I know it's not ideal, but we just thank you for that. I want to just convey a real quick message to you guys that our confidence does not come from ourselves or our circumstances. Our confidence comes from the Lord, and I hope you truly know that. And so I'd like for us to pray together, and we'll continue to worship through song, and then we'll open up God's Word in a few minutes too. Lord, we love you, we thank you, and we praise you for our confidence that is founded in you. God, you are bigger than our problems. You are bigger than this pandemic. You are bigger than our boredom. You are bigger than our woes and worries of cancellations and things not happening the way we want them to. And so, God, I pray that we put our faith and trust in you and that we would know wholeheartedly that you're in control and you're the one we need to turn our hearts and minds and attentions to. So, God, I pray that our confidence is founded in you and that we'll truly know that you're the one that we can turn to. You're the one that we can lean on. You're the one that we can count on because you are always faithful. We thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Nothing can separate, even if I run away. Your love never fails. life together for my good. You made all things work together for my good. You made all things work together for my good. You made all things work together for my good. You made all things work together for my good. You stay the same through the ages.
Hey guys, welcome back to Breakaway Online. I know that it'd be much more fun for us to be together, but we're here. And I thank you for taking the time to listen and tune in and really take some time to be a part of what we're looking and focusing on doing this week and in the weeks to come. Patrick and I have been talking about really what do we do, what kind of direction should we go in. We had a plan, we were going to go through Ecclesiastes, and I really don't think that was scratching itches on us as leaders as well as probably you as students. And so I think we needed to course correct, and we course corrected a few weeks ago with kind of an emphasis to kind of lead us into Easter. And now that we're done with Easter, I think one of the things that would be very beneficial for us to do is to truly look at, we've got more time, we've got more things going on that allow us to be home and to be focused on the thing. And why not take some of that energy and that time to really focus in on who we are in Jesus Christ and how we can grow and get better in that. And so we're going to be taking a look at the spiritual disciplines that we can put in our life to help us to grow and become more like Christ. Now, guys, this is not a bunch of lists of if you do these things, like add to your responsibilities, but really more of the idea along these lines is really to be able to put us in a situation to be able to receive more of what God has in store for us. I don't know about you guys, but I would hope that our lives would be lived out knowing that we want everything that God has in store for us. And I think the more time we can spend growing and becoming more like Him, getting these spiritual disciplines in our lives, helping us to be all that we can be for Him, I think that's going to be a great thing. And so really for the next several weeks, into the summer, we're going to be talking about spiritual disciplines and how we can put these in our lives and how we can grow and really receive all that God has in store for us. But I think tonight, one of the things we need to do is really start with this idea of the call of a disciple. Because if we don't start with the call of a disciple of why we're doing this, then really becoming disciplined in our spiritual walk and our discipleship is really going to be kind of cart before the horse. And so why don't we take some time tonight and really look at the call of a disciple. What is this call that Jesus has on our life that we're supposed to be doing, we're supposed to be walking in so that we can better function as followers of Christ? All right, and so we're going to be in two passages tonight, one in Mark chapter 1 and one in Romans chapter 15. So they'll be separated, have some time to move back and forth to them. But we're also going to just really take a look at characteristics tonight of a disciple and really just kind of see what Jesus has in store for us. All right, so let's dive right in Mark chapter 1, starting in verse 14. It says, "Now our Jesus was arrested. Jesus came to Galilee." Dang it. Hey, welcome back to Breakaway Online. We're glad that you're able to tune in with us and spend some time dialoguing later in your Zoom groups about what's going on here tonight. And we're super excited for, again, just the opportunity to do this. I know that it's not ideal. I would love to be in a room full of you guys, feeling your energy, seeing your smiling faces, hugging your necks, all those things. But the Lord has a different plan. And so this is where we are. And I'm so excited for just this opportunity. And I really pray that as you take some time tonight, as we open up God's Word, that you'll see that God has ordained these times, even in the craziness, for us to have a plan and a purpose and a time for us to come together and truly see that God is moving in our midst. And so Patrick and I have been talking about, what do we do after Easter? The Ecclesiastes study really wasn't kind of doing what we wanted it to do, and so we decided to course correct. And so what we're going to be doing for the next several weeks, leading into summer, maybe all the way through summer, is taking a look at spiritual disciplines, things that we need to put in our lives to help us to be better followers of Christ, to not so much to add more responsibilities and more do's and don'ts to our list, but really more of how we can better receive all that God has in store for us. Guys, I would hope that our greatest goal, our greatest passion in life would be to get everything that God has for us in this life. Not for us, but what God has in store for us. And guys, when we take time to do spiritual disciplines like spending time in God's Word, scripture memory, prayer, evangelism, fasting, the list goes on and on and on of things we're going to talk about in here. Really some ideas that you can do to put in your life to really help us to be the best followers of Christ we can be. And that's really what we want to do. Tonight we're going to really start with a focus on what is the call of a disciple. Because really, the call of a disciple is why we're doing this. I mean, why are you going to put spiritual disciplines in? Why are we going to do this? Why is Jesus calling us anyway? And so I think this is kind of where we're going to spend tonight. Well, I know we're going to spend time here tonight. And I pray that it's helpful and useful to you to really get the path going for us to see why we need to be focusing in on spiritual disciplines. So this call of a disciple is two passages we're going to look at tonight, Mark chapter 1 and Romans chapter 15. And so I pray that as you go through tonight that you'll be able to learn some things and apply some things to your life, maybe hold up a mirror to your life to see are these things truly reflecting you, and see how we can get better at being a disciple of Christ. All right, so let's jump right in. Mark chapter 1, starting in verse 14. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God, and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel." Verse 16, passing alongside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, the brother of Simon, casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you become fishers of men." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. And going a little further, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, who were in their boat mending the nets. And they immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with hired servants and followed him. I think one of the things that really just jumps out when you read this passage is the idea that Jesus says, "Follow me." Jesus says, "Follow me." And these guys dropped everything. They gave up everything they had in their life, everything that was going on in their world, to follow Jesus. And I don't know that we've actually had that moment where we've dropped everything to follow Jesus, but I believe that if you've put your faith and trust in him, there was a time where he said, "Follow me," and you chose to do that by putting your faith and trust in him as the only way you're going to get to heaven. And so guys, as we're looking at this idea of follow me, I think there's some important qualities that we need to understand that we can't obviously physically follow Jesus. So the goal here is that we take the idea of following God in his spiritual footsteps. Jesus walked on this earth, lived a perfect life, and he says, "Follow me." And I think that we need to be able to think about that and what that means for us today. And so I think the first thing that we look at is that it's a call to be set apart. You know, I hope that you understand that the idea of being holy is that you're set apart, that you're set aside for something special, something purposefully designed that God has for you. But it's also set apart because we're supposed to be different than the rest of the world. If you're going to follow Jesus, you shouldn't look like the people who don't follow Jesus. There shouldn't be anywhere close to that. You shouldn't be like trying to fit in. You should be trying to be set apart. The world should be looking at us and saying, "What's different about you?" in a positive text instead of a negative context. And I think one of the things that we got to do is we've chased after Jesus and realize he's got a better plan and a purpose for our life. Guys, if the world is falling in this direction, guess what we need to do? We probably need to go in this direction because God has a bigger plan for us, and we need to trust him in that. So Jesus says, "Follow me." It's not going to be the path of least resistance. It's not going to be the greatest path and the smoothest path, but it's going to be the path with the most rewards for all eternity. And guys, I hope that's what you're thinking. I know you're young and we're thinking, "Oh, that's so far in the future," but none of us know that. And so the call to follow me that Jesus is asking us is a call to be set apart. It's also a call to be challenged. This idea of being challenged is that when we read God's Word, when we open up his Word, it should challenge us. It should cause us to kind of wreck us a little bit, because when we're reading God's Word, we're applying it. We're observing it and we're applying it. And the idea of applying it in our lives should have something that says, I need to course correct. I need to do something better. I need something different in my life because of what Scripture says. And so the challenge comes from Scripture. The challenge comes from the Holy Spirit encouraging us to do things that we should do and not do things that we shouldn't do. There's a challenge in that, to accept that calling that he's called in our lives. At the same time, there's a challenge that you're going to hear from more mature believers. The people who are discipling you, the people who are leading you. They're going to challenge you. They're going to hold you accountable for things. Your friends, your peers can do that as well, to hold you accountable. There's no challenge involved in that. Guys, our friendship with Jesus Christ and our friendships in Jesus Christ should be different. And those relationships should be found in the fact that God has called us to a greater standard, to be set apart, to be challenged, because we're following Jesus. We're not following some teacher. We're following Jesus. And so we need to think about that and make sure that we're totally on board with this idea that he's calling us to be set apart, outside the norm of the society, and to be challenged as well. At the same time, to be taught. Guys, I've been a Christian for 30-something years. I'm in my late 40s, and there's so much more I can be taught. And so I know that none of us can say we've arrived at this place and we've accomplished all that we need to and we don't need to worry about it anymore. No, the follow me is to be taught. We need to be taught by the Holy Spirit. We need to be taught by God's Word. This Word needs to become part of our life and not just something that's just there, but really something that we jump into and it becomes part of who we are. We need to be taught by our pastors and our leaders and our shepherds, our teachers, whatever the case may be. We need to be able to be taught by them. And we have to have a teachable spirit. You know, you can't follow somebody if you're not willing to be taught by them. It's just, you got to understand that. And so because of that, I really hope that as we go through tonight, you'll see these are some things that I need to put in my life. And so this idea of follow me, kind of to summarize, it's to adhere to the call and the mission Christ gave us. This idea of adhering is like that stickiness, that the call of following Jesus Christ is sticking to us. What we read in Scripture sticks to us. When we pray about sticks to us, when we sing a worship song, it sticks to us because all of this is part of the call that God has for us to be more like Jesus. And if we're going to follow his call, and we need to follow his mission as well, and his mission was here when Jesus was on this earth, he said, I came to seek and to save that which was lost. And then he challenged us to go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that he's commanded. That's a pretty big deal. And the cool thing is that he's calling us to be a part of that mission. He wants us to be a part of helping those people who are not saved to become saved, to become disciples and followers of Jesus Christ. And so this idea of disciples is really the next thing, because if you look on Mark chapter 1, verse 16, it says, calling the first disciples. He said, follow me, because I want you to be my disciples. I want you to follow me. And so this idea of disciple is someone who follows another's teaching and adheres to it. Jesus is calling us to be his disciples. When you became a Christian, you became a disciple. There's not like this layer, like you become a Christian and you hang out for a couple years and then you have to think. No, when you become a Christian, you are a disciple of Jesus Christ. And so you need to follow Jesus' teachings founded in God's Word. And you need to adhere to them, like I said, this idea that you stick to what's going on. And this idea of having this Jesus stick to you, there should be a desire that you have to imitate who Jesus is and what's going on in your life to look like his. You have a desire to imitate Jesus. How do we know how Jesus lived? It's written in here, guys. It's written here, page after page after page, calling us and showing us what Jesus did, who he was, how he lived. And all of it was to bring honor and glory to God. And if we're going to imitate Jesus, our lives should be about bringing honor and glory to God. We also need to look at the idea of discipleship. The whole student ministry has been designed around a process of becoming a disciple, becoming a fully functioning follower of Jesus Christ. And the disciple that we are called in that is a process. God called us to be his disciples. Well, discipleship is that process, guys. And we have it set up for you to be in discipleship relationships so that there's a time where you become from being a disciplee to becoming a disciple maker. And I truly hope that you know that and you see that is an opportunity that you have here in this church. And I pray every church you ever go to, that's a big important part of it, is that your discipleship is a big part of it. Guys, as I said before, when you're a Christian, you're a disciple. And you're a Christian because you've put Jesus Christ inside of you. Dietrich Bonhoeffer says it this way. He says, Christianity without discipleship is always Christianity without Christ. Wow, think about that, guys. It remains an abstract idea, a myth which has a place for the fatherhood of God, but omits Christ as the living Son. There is a trust in God, but no following of Christ. If we're not involved in discipleship, we're just like the rest of the world. You can talk about God, you can believe about God, that's cool, but don't talk about Jesus. If you really want Jesus to get up in here and to really do some stuff in your life and to really course correct your life and put you on a path and keep you on a path, then discipleship is the path that you need to be on to do that. And so this call to becoming a disciple is a call to becoming more like Jesus. And Jesus has to be our focus. We can't do discipleship without Jesus Christ. It's building a relationship, discipleship, around God's word where Jesus is the focus. But here's the thing, guys. You think, oh, well, I'm going to go through the student ministry, I'm going to graduate from 12th grade, and then I'm not going to do this anymore. No. Discipleship is a lifestyle, and it must never stop. Guys, I pray that I never stop making disciples. I pray that I'm never too old, too mature to not be taught myself. And I pray that every single one of us has that same idea, that same mantra in our life, that we want discipleship to be about who we are. 7th, 8th, 9th grade, you're a disciplee. 10th, 11th, 12th grade, you become a disciple maker in younger kids. When you graduate from the youth group, you can go to college. And if you feel that you are able to disciple other people that you can walk with, then go, then do that. If you feel you want to be discipled more, then you have that opportunity too. But it's nothing that ever should stop. But here's the thing, you think, well, how do I know if I'm ready to do this? Am I ready? Am I mature enough? Well, check this out, guys. Discipleship is about living our lives for Christ following, learning, listening, observing, and experiencing life directly with Jesus through his words, along with the counsel and instruction of godly, mature Christians. Well, you think, well, how do I know if I'm a godly, mature Christian? Well, let me just simplify it for you like this. To be able to disciple somebody, you have to be one step ahead. Think about that. One step ahead. You're just that little bit right in front of them. You're just a little bit ahead of them. All that means is that you have the ability to help them walk in that direction. That's why 10th graders can disciple 7th graders. That's why college students can do youth. That's why you could disciple somebody who's older than you because you're more mature in your Christian faith. Think about that. You could be in your 20s and somebody gets saved in their 40s. You could be a great person to walk with them and help them grow in Christ. And so discipleship is a process I hope you never, ever want to get out of, and you understand that it's a calling for your life. This sounds kind of deep. It sounds kind of scary. It's like, man, is this going to be something that's worth it? Well, check this out. In Romans chapter 15, guys, starting in verse 1, it says, "We are strong. We who are strong have obligation to bear with the failings of the weak and not to please ourselves." Well, here's a calling for discipleship, guys. We need to help those who are weak to become stronger. They're going to make mistakes, but not do it because for ourselves. But let each of us please his neighbor for his good to build him up. Discipleship should be about getting somebody and increasing their level in their walk and their maturity with Christ so that they can therefore then go and become a disciple maker themselves. Verse 3 says, "For Christ did not please himself, but as is written, the reproaches of those who reproached you fell on me." Well, what this is talking about is that people were saying that they didn't like the way God was doing things, so they took it out on Jesus. Well, guess what? People don't like Jesus, they're going to take it on us as Christ followers. And so, oh man, this got worse. Now people are going to not like me? Yeah, that's kind of possible and likely because Scripture says it's going to go through. But check this out. Verse 4 gets more better here. It says, "For whatever was written in the former days was written for our instruction, that through endurance and through the encouragement of the Scriptures, we might have hope." May the God of endurance and encouragement grant you to live in such harmony with each and with one another in according with Jesus Christ, that together you may, with the Father, with one voice, glorify God and Father, our Lord Jesus Christ. Think about that, guys. The hope that we have should be the thing that spurs us on. The hope that we have should be the reason why we want to be discipling people. The hope that we have should be why we want to do this at all. Why? Because hope is heaven. The difficulties, the struggles, the hardships of this world are going to be failed nothing in comparison to the glory of heaven. And that's the hope that we have, and the hope that was created by Jesus dying on a cross. Because the only way we can pay for sin is through the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And so Jesus is our hope. Verse 13, remember verse for the week. "May the God of all hope fill you with joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope." Guys, this call, this process of following Jesus and being disciple is given to us by God, but it's empowered by God too with the Holy Spirit and with the understanding that Jesus came to this earth, he lived and he died for you and for me, and he wants you to do the same thing, to live our lives to honor and glorify God. He gave us the Holy Spirit so that we could abound in hope, that this excitement that we have in our walk with Jesus Christ is not just this temporary thing, but that it's real, that's deep, that Jesus Christ did and paid for. And so when we take a look at these things, I think there's several things that we can grab from these verses and other verses that we'll look at. These ideas that they're characteristics that we should have of a disciple. Characteristics of being a disciple should have these things. Guys, these are things that I hope that we're going to go through them and we're going to talk about them, but I really hope that as you look at them, you realize that they are things that you can accomplish in your life through the power of the Holy Spirit, through spending time investing in God's Word, through accountability. But they're things that need to be evident in our lives, that when people look at us, they see these things. And so these are the characteristics. The first one is abiding in God's Word. Dale says this all the time, that you know all the problems in this world, all the struggles we have in this world is probably because we're not spending enough time in God's Word. Abiding in God's Word is not just reading soap verses and checking a box. Abiding in God's Word is having it dwell in you and you dwell in it. You're spending time in it. Check this out in John chapter 8, verses 31 and 32. It says, Jesus said to the Jews who had believed him, if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciple. And you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. Think about that, guys. The dynamic that Jesus says, I want you to abide in my word because it's going to be truth. It's going to set you free. And when people know that your word is, that the word of God is in you so much that it comes out of you, people are going to know that you're his disciples. So abiding in God's word is the first one. The second one is bearing much fruit. Guys, if you're a spiritual tree, what fruit are you producing that's spiritual in nature? What is a byproduct of your life in Christ that's showing itself in fruit? John 15 verse 8 says, by this my Father is glorified that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. God is glorified by the fruit that we produce in our lives. There should be things that we're trying to do in our lives that produce spiritual fruit. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Above such things there is no law. That's the fruit of the Spirit. Those should be things that are part of our lives. They should be coming out of our lives. But the first one of those fruit of the Spirit is love, and loving one another should be a very evident byproduct of us being a disciple of Christ. John 13, 34 says, a new commandment I give to you, that you love one another. Just as I have loved you, you also love one another. By this, all people will know that you are my disciples if you love one another. Think about this. The world will know you follow Jesus by how you love people. Flip that around. Do people know you follow Jesus by how you love people? Do people know that? Abiding in God's word, bearing much fruit, loving one another. In Luke chapter 14, we see a couple things here. We see, number one, we see cross-bearing. Cross-bearing, whoever does not bear his own cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. The idea here is you got to die to self. You can't sit there and live and honor and glorify yourself. You have to take up your cross, sacrifice you, and put on Jesus Christ and show the world that you're following Jesus. Another verse in Luke chapter 14 is verse 33. It's the idea of forsaking all. It says, so therefore, anyone of who does not renounce all that he has cannot be my disciple. This renounce is forsaking it. What do you have that's worth more than Jesus Christ? The call here is for us to put our faith and trust in him and to know that his plan, his purposes are better, and so therefore everything else is worthless. I forsake all things so that I may know Christ. Next is servant-minded. Mark chapter 9, verses 35. It says, sitting down, Jesus called the 12 and said, anyone who wants to be first must be very last and a servant of all. The idea here is that we need to be servant-minded. We need to be servant-minded, focused in on his goal, his plan, his purpose for our life. Because he tells us, if you want to be great in the kingdom, you got to be a servant. Sometimes we have this backwards in our world that if we're super, then we'll get treated differently. God's word says if you serve other people, you'll be exalted and you'll be in first place. So guys, those are a couple of them. The last one here is humbling yourself. It kind of goes along with that idea of the servant-minded. Humble yourself. Matthew chapter 11, verse 29 says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and I will find rest for your souls." What God is saying here is, quit striving for your own and take on what I have for you. The goals, the plans, and the purposes that God has for you, we have to humble ourselves to get under that and realize that His plans are better. He's going to do it better. He's going to accomplish it better. He's going to achieve it better in us. And we need to humble ourselves before God to do that. And the humility that we have in choosing God's path over our path is also going to show people that we are a follower of Jesus Christ and we're a disciple. So let me just review real quick these seven characteristics. Abide in God's word, bear much fruit, and we love one another. We're cross-bearing, we're forsaking all, we're servant-minded, and we're humble. I really hope these are characteristics that define you. And as we move into application, the first question really does that. Does your life reflect being a disciple? Do these characteristics that we've listed off, do they reflect who you are? If people were to look at your life, would they see these attributes in your life? Would they see these characteristics coming out of you and saying you are a follower of Christ and therefore I know that you're a disciple? Are these reflecting that? Would people have enough evidence that these things exist in your life? Second thing to that question ask yourself is, do you see discipleship as something the church does, or is it really a calling from God? Is it really a calling from the Lord? Here's the thing. So often we go through the process of growing up in church and kind of just doing what the church does. Well, this is not a call of just do what the church does. This is a call to be a disciplee so that you can become a disciple maker. And so I hope that as you think through this, that you realize that this path that we're on is not just to accomplish a task, to check a box, and to do these things, make our parents happy, make older people happy, whatever the case may be. The call here is for us to live our lives under the calling of Jesus Christ. He said, go and make disciples, and you can't make disciples if you're not one. You can't be a parked car and leave anybody anywhere. Because you're a parked car, you're not going anywhere. If you're not a disciple, if you're not imitating, following Jesus, you're not going to lead anybody to do the same thing. And lastly, what characteristics of a disciple do you need the most accountability with? Guys, I think this is what your Zoom calls that will follow this should be really about tonight. Taking this question and really spending some time. How can my small group help me be more like Jesus? How can these characteristics that we've talked about tonight be evident in my life? When people spend time with me, they talk with me, how can they do that? And guys, girls, asking your small group to help you to be more accountable on that. Asking questions. How did you do with your ability to abide in God's word this week? How did you do with your ability to bear much fruit this week, this month, whatever the case may be? But asking the questions of how can we help you grow and become all that God has in store for you? So guys, there's a call that God has on our life to be a disciple. And we're not just to be a disciple just for the following sake. It's also that we can call people to do the same thing. Paul said, follow me as I follow Christ. Imitate me as I follow Christ. The call to be a disciple maker is that you're asking people to follow you because you're going to show them how to follow Jesus Christ. And I pray that you do that, guys. I pray that you want that. Let's pray. Father in heaven, I thank you so much for this call of being a disciple. First and foremost, I think it's a call from you. And it's not a call that we have to muster up inside of us. It's a call from you, and it's empowered by you and empowered by the Holy Spirit living inside of us. So, Father, I pray that this call to being a disciple is first a call that we answer in putting our faith and trust in Jesus Christ, that we believe that He's the only way to get to heaven, He's the only way to live this life worth living at all. But, Lord, it's also an opportunity for us to realize, Lord, that it's not just this problem about receiving, receiving, receiving. It's about receiving to a point that you're able to give back to other people. And so, Lord, I pray that as we follow Christ, we see the ability to become a disciple maker. As we grow in our discipleship, we become more desiring to disciple other people. So, God, I pray that you would help us to walk in that, and I would help you to see that as a calling of you. The Great Commission says to make disciples. It should be that simple, God. But we need your help, and we need your power, and we need your Holy Spirit to give us all that we need in this world. So God, I love you and I praise you and I thank you for this call and I thank you for your willingness to help us accomplish it. Lord, call us to yourself. Call us to be more disciplined in our walk with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Guys, I have one quick announcement. It's pretty obvious, I would think, but that is we're supposed to have a summer informational meeting this Sunday, April 19th, talking about all the plans of the summer and what we're doing and how much it's going to cost and all those things. It's been postponed, obviously, because we can't gather. I don't want to have a meeting like this over Zoom because there's lots of questions and things like that. And there's also, guys, a lot of variables that Patrick and I don't have answers to right now. There's some things that we don't know, how Denver's going to work, how youth camp's going to work, what other things can we do, what can we do, when is this thing going to end so that we can start preparing for any of these things. So guys, what we're going to do is postpone this meeting until we get a chance to get more information and also a time for us to gather and meet. And so again, don't know when that is, but when we have an idea, we'll begin giving you information, pointing you in the direction you need, and making sure that you have all that you need for information for whatever God has in store for us this summer. Guys, thanks again. Love you, and we'll see you next time.